unlike other classics. West Side Story grows younger. Classics. West Side Story grows younger.
I can't believe campaigning with Dick Cheney didn't work. Welcome to Movie Humpers.
Hey. Well,
my name is Bob Sham.
My name is Angela.
The sounds of your maybe dogs. And it is, you know, well, we're doing our Lars von Trier, year of von Trier, because we knew the year would be shit. So just pile on.
Mm-hmm.
And boy, yeah, it didn't disappoint, did it? But, you know, after all that mess, we got some singing and dancing we got to cover. For this month, our theme is Raise the Curtain and Belt the Chorus. Musicals adapted to film all month long. You booked it.
I did.
You booked all this. And you booked the one we're talking about today. One of the most infamous musicals. The majority of musicals I am watching for the first time this month. I've maybe only watched three or four musicals before this month. So this will multiply that. But I know enough about what we're talking about today. Like, I know it's based on Romeo and Juliet. I know from watching that amazing movie, Maestro, Leonard Bernstein,
yeah,
that he had something to do with the music here. If someone doesn't sing at you, nothing will sing at you.
Who left Snoopy?
Who abandoned Snoopy in the vestibule?
Who left Snoopy in the vestibule? Yeah, we're talking about the movie West Side Story from 1961. directed by Robert Wise, written by Ernest Lehman, Jerome Robbins, Leonard Bernstein, Stephen Sondheim. You didn't know that you picked a Stephen Sondheim. You like musicals, but you get your guys flipped around, I noticed. Because last week you're like, I wish I picked some Sondheim. And you did here. Also, Arthur Laurent, starring Natalie Wood, Richard Boehmer, Russ Tamblyn, Rita Moreno, amongst others. Cinematography by Daniel L. Pfaff. Music by Leonard Bernstein. West Side Story. It won Best Picture that year.
Sondheim is notoriously difficult to sing. He goes very quickly. Some of these songs even feel like they're not being sung well because the notes they're hitting are so bizarre.
Yeah, with Tony's little solo, the talk singing thing.
Any day I will know right away, soon as it shows. It make 'em cannonballing down through the sky, gleaming its eye bright as a rose. It's only just out of reach, down the block on a beach, under a tree. I got a feeling there's a miracle due, gonna come true, coming to me.
I'm watching it and I'm thinking, like, what if he changed it a little? This might sound a little better, but you explain that that's the Sondheim way, the specific way of doing that. And when they're actually doing, like, you know, when Tony's with Maria and they're actually singing, like, it does sound very nice. You can tell that that actor does have talent. But it just, for someone who's not accustomed to this type of entertainment, it really takes some adjustment there.
The only thing I can think, I was trying to figure out that song in particular, the first Tony song, the someday, maybe, you know, he's thinking something's going to happen. The only thing I can figure in that song is it's a hopeful song, but because it sounds so off, it's almost foreshadowing more in the way he's singing the song than what he's saying. Yeah. That maybe it's not going to be such a good thing that happens.
Yeah, there does seem to be something very tentative about the way that actor approaches. And when you explain it like that, it does seem a little smarter.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, after we watched this, you showed me some Sondheim live stage examples. You showed a thing on Into the Woods, which I actually thought was pretty well executed.
I really like that
show. Where a lot of people were doing that talk singing thing, but it was completely layered and back and forth quite a bit. And this story, this musical is beloved. And I think this is a good movie.
Mm-hmm.
But people are like, this won Best Picture. And I don't know what else. I can't remember what else came out in 61, but I'm sure I could pick a different one. But that's always the case with the Academy, right? Maestro should have won Best Picture last year.
Can I tell you a secret? You know, I slept with both your parents.
This may have been the first musical I ever saw as a child because this was my dad's favorite musical.
I think that's the thing with this particular musical. It does become a lot of people's first musical. There is an accessibility to it because it's based upon a story that is often the first Shakespeare story that you learn growing. Like that's one of the few Shakespeare things that's like middle school level that you can read through. And so the story there is timeless. Young lovers from opposite sides coming together. But let me tell you, if I was round in a corner out in these streets and I walked around the corner and a young Russ Tamblyn was there doing splits, doing like high arcing splits in the air, and like, I would shit my pants. I'd be like, oh, a real deal fucking gang is coming down this alley right now.
It's so dancey. They fight dance. It's all choreography, which is so interesting to watch because I have not seen the remake of this movie. I wonder,
the Steven Spielberg remake,
if now they did that same kind of thing, because it does feel of a different era. It feels very much like they're on the stage, even though, I mean, they're on a soundstage, but it doesn't feel real because you wouldn't be dancing like that when you're fighting. So there is this little bit of like,
it is
it's silly.
And this is like classic style Broadway,
yes.
Right?
Oh, yes.
I mean, I understand what I'm watching.
Yeah.
I'm not going to be like, that's not how gangs work.
But there is a silliness to it.
There is.
There's a fun, even when they're fighting and they're saying they're going to kill each other. It's silly. There's jokes. There's gags.
It is. It's played tongue-in-cheek. Mm-hmm. But, and I actually think that is entertaining when we're going into the intro and we're snapping and we're being introduced to the Jets and the Sharks. The Jets are hodgepodge white European kids. And the Sharks are Puerto Rican kids. They're fighting over a street in a city. Oh, west side of New York City. Oh, the opening of the movie, really interesting style, which we get the overture and just like this image. And the background of the image is like a bunch of lines going up and down for like the front half of the page. Of the screen, and the overture is playing while the background's changing colors, and my brain was being tricked because I thought additional lines were coming in. It wasn't.
No, I know, but I thought so too.
But my brain was being tricked into thinking that I was seeing like a drawing develop. But I did know that what I was looking at appeared to be a minimized representation of a city. Mm-hmm. And sure enough, after the overture's done playing, you got Manhattan opening up. So. And I actually thought that was kind of, that little artistic touch there was kind of neat. And it made it feel very different. But then we're, you know, then we get into the finger snaps and the jumping splits.
I think the fun in that first bit, the silliness, they're painting each other, pouring things on each other, you know, jumping around. And there is this little bit of we're fighting, but we know this is just what we always do. Feels lighthearted compared to later when it becomes serious. Like we're actually really going to fight and there's knives and people are going to get hurt and we're tired of doing this dance with each other. I looked at it differently watching it now. When I was a kid, I don't even think I really remember the last bit of it.
Well, I guess because I know the story of Romeo and Juliet, this will be a tragedy, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But, you know, Tony, he hangs with the Jets, but he's been helping the old man out in the shop, and he's kind of been separating from the gang life, but he's still got his buddies. His buddy, what's his name, Jizz?
Riff.
It's played by Russ Tamblyn. Riff, he loves Tony, and he's like, yeah, we're going to go. They agree with the Jets and the Sharks. They're going to go rumble, right? They do a big fight. Riff is going to Tony, played by Richard Boehmer, and he's like, yeah, we're going to go fucking rumble with these fucking puertos.
And he wants Tony to stand up with him, and Tony tries to say, look, I'm not really a Jet anymore. I'm trying to build a life for myself. I work here with Doc. I love you, but this is not who I am. Mm. But because they're such close friends, like brothers, he just agrees. He said, okay, I'll stand up and be your second.
Tony feels obligated to watch out for him because they're best friends.
So there's going to be this dance.
Yeah.
Which is interesting because these folks are young adults. They're not high school kids. This isn't a high school dance, but it's this community dance that's being put on, and everyone's going to the dance.
I like the idea that the community just dances in a building, even if they don't like each other. They're like, we got to go to the dance.
Right.
But we'll establish rules for our rumble, or we'll set up the rumble here at this dance, right? And it is fun to watch them go back and forth, and there's like a teacher there. Oh, I thought I misidentified him. The guy who's talking to them all, who seems like a game show host. Or
he wants
like
to get them to like dance with each other like across lines.
Like a Corny Collins type character. I misidentified him as one of the Smothers Brothers. He's actually the guy that played the original Gomez Adams.
That's okay.
But
yeah.
he's uncredited in this movie.
Crazy.
You know, back then there wasn't these long credit sequences. So, but yeah, we get some fun dancing there, and then in comes, well, we meet her before that, but Tony locks eyes with Maria. I was like, is that Natalie Wood? This is the third Natalie Wood movie we've watched. Do you remember what the other two are?
The John Ford movie.
The Searchers, yes.
And Miracle on 34th
Street.
Yeah,
you got it. Usually you don't get my pop quizzes, but you got that one.
I couldn't think of The Searchers, but I pulled the director, which I think counts.
So a lot of our extended sharks do seem to be Latino, Puerto Rican, or whatever.
Yes.
But now our lead, you know, the most acceptable fake Latino is Razor Ramon, Scott Hall, the wrestler, who is Razor Ramon.
What is this, man?
It's the Bill Senor Razor.
You got a bill for me, man? You know who I am, man? I am Razor Ramon. People find out I eat in this restaurant, they line up down the street, Chico. Get out of here, man. What's next? Maybe I could mop the floor for you, huh, man? You like that?
Razor Ramon, a little different.
He is the most accepted fake Latino. Is Natalie Wood a widely accepted fake Latina for the sake of West Side Story
She's
love?
She's beloved in this movie. And personally, never heard anyone complain about it. It's not like Mickey Rooney and Breakfast at Tiffany's. Nobody's talking about it, you know, in
that
way.
That's
it's not something
true.
That comes up in that conversation. There's people that you tick off when you talk about things like that. I've never heard this one brought up.
I think even in hindsight, I mean, we know why Natalie Wood. It is, there is like, going back, it is for racist reasons why, you know, Rita Moreno's right there. Problem, she's a little older at that time.
I don't know. She sings and she's great, yeah. But she is very much more of like a belter in this movie. I haven't seen enough of her to know if she has that
range. She's more classically
range.
Trained on the stage than
Natalie is,
at least in the musicals aspect.
Yeah.
But yeah, it is weird that
she was a darling back then, though. You
she
know,
was
that
like,
was,
yeah.
She was super hot. So you put Natalie Wood in the starring role.
But even without knowing like the Spielberg West Side Story cast, I'm sure he put an actual Latina woman there.
He did.
And it makes sense why it should be, especially if everyone else is Latina. So you got to wonder what the rest of that, I mean, they've got to be used to it being typecast in that era to be like, we're all standing behind fake Latina Natalie Wood. But sometimes, you know, white people will react, like if a white guy wears a sombrero, other white people might be like, hey, that's appropriation or something. But I found that, especially with sombrero Mexican culture, they don't seem to be wound up about that stuff. They see it as in their culture being influenced upon people. That seems to be the general take that I've hear every time I expect something different from that. I don't know if that's going to be the case with Natalie Wood. It's literally brown face here.
Yeah, like, it's different when you're putting on an accent and you're trying to culturally say that something you're not.
Richard Boehmer looks no less Puerto Rican than Natalie Wood, while Natalie Wood's brother, Bernardo, looks Puerto Rican.
Absolutely. Bernardo and Maria are the two that we get to know the most. They're standing next to her most of the time. She does not look Puerto Rican.
No.
But she does the accent.
Anita, it is now to be a dress for dancing, no longer for praying.
You can tell she worked really hard to try to sound the way she should have, but it was almost over. I'm just saying,
yes,
you
it was over.
It was affected in this way that, I know, she rolled too many R's. But I guess what I'm trying to say is she was really trying. She went a little overboard.
She wasn't trying to clown it. It just
she just wanted to do it well, and it was a lot.
Yeah. Rita Moreno is Bernardo's girlfriend, Anita. Rita Moreno, a babe.
Love Rita Moreno.
A babe back then, right?
Yes.
I mean, the Puerto Rican women are... Fun movie fact. The movie... Christine, the killer car, Christine was Puerto Rican.
I'm not surprised.
That explains a lot, doesn't
it? Yes, it does. She's fiery.
I meant to make that joke when we recorded that. So now I have the opportunity here. Tony and Maria lock eyes, just like old Romeo and Juliet did. And then they have, they meet later and they have a little singing thing, much like the balcony scene.
I did want to talk about their meeting because... This was something that I don't think you see anymore, but happened a lot in old musical movies where there would be this otherworldly thing happening, like I'm seeing you for the first time or I'm falling in love with you, where you leave the place that you are. So everyone else blurred out and they only could see each other. But they literally did that. They blurred everyone out and they could only see each other.
I don't know how they did it. It looked like Vaseline was around the whole shot except for right their spot.
Yeah.
I mean, it was interesting.
But then it even melded away to where I think at one point they were just against like stars or something. So it truly was hitting you over the head with these are the only two people in the world for each other.
Sure.
They are meant to be. This was a fated meeting. She is there with Chino. Chino is the guy that her brother has approved of that she is supposed to be dating. This is the first time she's come out of the house as a grown woman. This is her kind of introduction to this world. She knows these people, but she's not been allowed to go out and be social. I guess that means she's like 18.
Yeah.
You know, she's one of the younger ones. But yeah, it's just there's moments like that in these older musicals that when I was a kid, I thought were really silly. Like there's a really long dancing sequence in Oklahoma.
Sure.
This kind of comes out of it and you're like just ballet and stuff. And so, I don't know, seeing that actually made me feel very nostalgic for the movies I used to watch when I was a little kid.
You know, when I, not to go, not to harp too much on the fake Latina thing,
yeah.
But I will. Natalie Wood, actually, if you think about it, was probably way ahead of her time being a fake Latina. Because you remember like just 2 years ago where a lot of women and a lot of those so-called Instagram influencers were darkening their hair and bronzing their skin and showing their ass a lot. Like it seemed like the fake Latina look was really hot for like a couple of years. Natalie Wood just launched that off, you know?
Except she didn't really darken her hair, and I guess she got a tan, but I don't know.
So
she didn't do all that.
The Jets and the Sharks, they meet at docks to have the rules of their rumble, because that's what they're going to do after the dance late that night.
They're having like a sit down.
All this takes place in like 2 days, right?
Yes.
And they have a sit down. They have a weird respect for each other despite being insulting. But then one of the cops comes in. Who is that? Lieutenant Schrank, who is openly racist against the Sharks and openly dislikes the Jets. Mm-hmm. But he seems to dislike the Sharks a little more. But it doesn't make the Jets trust Schrank, even though the Jets could probably, on a political level, use some leverage based on their race to get, but they have that gang code of like, even if it's to your benefit, you don't snitch.
Exactly.
Or anything.
Because there is a point where that guy, the first day, because you're right, it's 2 days earlier this same day, that lieutenant and then Officer Krumke show up and they're like, what's going on? And even the Jets are like, oh, nothing, officer. Everything's just fine, when they were fighting. Because, yeah, no one wants to be the snitch. No one's going to tell. You're also admitting you're fighting as well if you say that there was a fight.
I ought to take it down a station and throw you in a can right now. You and the tin-horn immigrant scum you come from. How's your old man's DTs, Arab? How's the action on your mother's side of the street, action? You know, one of these days there won't be anybody to hold you.
He takes off the cop, and everyone's just kind of disgusted by him. He tells the Sharks to beat it, and Bernardo looks at Russ Tamblyn. Russ Tamblyn's like a head nod, like, yeah, it's on. And they agree to a rumble, thanks to Tony, just with fists, no weapons. And so Tony goes to Maria later, and he's like, they're going to rumble, but they're just going to beat each other up. They're not pulling out pipes and knives. Everything's cool. And Maria's like, no, you need to, like, go down there and stop. If you have the ability to convince them to be slightly less violent, you need to go down there and just stop it. So he goes down there, and they're under the bridge. You know what happens to poor Mercutio in Romeo and Juliet. Shit goes down, and Tony's trying to block it, but then Bernardo, I forget who pulls the knife
Bernardo,
first.
Bernardo, I believe, pulled the knife first. He stabbed Riff,
yeah,
and killed him, and then Tony
kind of
lost his shit because this is like his brother. He grabs the knife that Riff had and stabs Bernardo.
Yeah, so both these boys are dead.
And he's
losing his shit.
Losing it, and he goes to Maria and crawls in through her window, and I think they fuck.
Yeah, I think it does imply.
Because that's what happens to Romeo and Juliet. They have one night together.
Yeah, she's really upset that her brother's dead, but she understands that it was like a heat of the moment thing. So
yeah, he didn't mean for it to happen.
Too mad at Tony, but the Jets are on the run, and everyone's like hiding out. And oh, there's a character called Anybody's. We know now. We didn't have as much knowledge back then, but we know now that Anybody's is a transgender boy.
Yeah.
Could a real zip gun make you do like that?
I know what a zip gun can make you do. You better wear diapers.
Go walk the streets like your sister.
Listen, jailbait, I licked you twice and I can do it again!
They just called her a tomboy back then.
Yeah, they tell her to go put on a dress,
yeah,
go home, you're a girl, yeah.
But Anybody's is the one that hides in the shadows and brings information and clarifies things when there's misunderstandings. And
Anybody's helps,
yeah,
so much more than the other ones.
Anybody seems like the most fun role to play. play, like you could really play it up. Anybody's is a transgender man. This is ahead of its time. I really only like four songs in this whole movie. I like the America song that the Puerto Ricans sing. We're talking about the ups and downs of living in America.
Here you are free and you have pride.
Long as you stay on your own side.
Free to be anything you choose.
Free to wear devils and shine shoes.
And a couple more, but I also like the Be Cool song where the Jets are in some carport and they have to just like calm each other down. And so the guy who's left, who's taken over for your jizz, he's like trying to calm everyone down, and that little sequence is pretty cool. But we're nearing the end of the movie.
Maria and Tony have spent the night together. Rita Moreno comes in the next morning, finds them together, but Tony leaves because he needs to go hide because they're going to try to leave. They're going to try to get out. He's going to go to Doc and borrow some money, and then Maria's going to come and meet him at Doc's, and they're going to leave town because it's the only way they can be together. So he goes and hides at Doc's. The cops come. So the officer comes to Maria's house and wants to ask a bunch of questions because her brother's dead, and I don't know if he knows about her and Tony, but he needs to talk to her. So she asks, what is Rita Moreno's character's name?
Anita.
She asks Anita to please go to Tony for her and tell Tony that she's coming, but she's late. That she will be there, but she can't be there right now. Anita goes. Anita doesn't want to, but she goes. She understands that Maria loves this man. The problem is that when she gets to Doc's, Doc is not there at the moment because he's gone to get the cash.
The Jets are, and he's stashed in the basement.
Yep, and the Jets are there.
There's a lot of straight-up racial insulting going on.
Yes.
And at one point, one of the Jets calls the Puerto Ricans, maybe says it to Anita or whatever.
Bernardo's pig.
You're lying spick.
Don't do that.
Oh, toothpick.
Garlic mouth.
Garlic eaters.
Yeah.
Garlic mouth.
Which is interesting because much of the world does enjoy a garlic diet. But I actually think this was an insightful slur in that I think that that Jet just recognized that a couple of these Puerto Ricans look a little Italian. Can you imagine being insulted by spices and herbs that you use in your daily cuisine? Like, oh, here comes we got a couple of cardamoms coming down the street. Look at this shit.
The smoked paprika.
What is for white people? What is
salt?
Oh yes, it's got to be salt, right? Oh, it's fucking salty all day.
This gets pretty rough. This is one of the most upsetting scenes because she's trying to go and she says she's there to see Tony, and they tell her Tony's not here. But then they start kind of roughing her up and get her in the center of the crowd and they get her down on the ground. They're going to rape her.
They look like they were
going
to rape her.
They were going
and
to rape
Doc
her.
Doc had to be like, "What the fuck is wrong?"
He comes
with
in and
people?
He's like, "You guys fucking stop it right now!" But she, you know, obviously is extremely upset and she's mad. And so she says,
you tell that murderer that Maria's never going to meet him. You tell him that Gino found out about them and shot her.
Yeah. Maria is dead.
Which she made up. So she's like, so you salties and Yorkshire puddings, get the fuck out of here. So she leaves. They go and tell Tony, and Tony thinks that Maria's dead. So Tony is just wandering the streets, like just broken.
Yelling for Chino.
And he's yelling for Chino.
He's like, come and fucking get me.
And then he sees Maria walking down the street. And right when he's like, oh my God, she's alive, an angel, Chino fucking shoots him.
And then
Maria takes him in his arms as he's dying. And the gangs come together, watching Tony die while Maria's just fucking pissed at everybody.
Yeah, and she looks at them all and says, this is your fault.
Yeah.
And it's heartbreaking.
And then at the end she looks at the camera and goes, this is definitely a West Side Story. West Side Story from 1961, directed by Robert Wise, one of the more beloved musicals. And I see why. I mean, the Sondheimness of it, if you're not used to it, as we've gone over. Otherwise, it seems fairly introductory because of the story it's based on. Well, this cost $6.7 million, made $44
million. Wow.
And which is great for 61. Yeah. And as I said, it made Best Picture. There's no shortage of nostalgia and praise. I don't know about the Spielberg one. I mean, maybe it's good. I don't know if it's the same story. I wasn't blown away by all the song choices. I think it is a good movie. But if we're going to go 1 through 5 each combined for best out of 10, I'm falling right at a 4 for West Side Story.
I agree. I'm going to go with a 4 as well.
I think it is a solid 8 musical.
Yeah, it really is.
And there's enough unique things about it, a few turns. The cinematography's good.
Mm-hmm.
It's a well-made movie.
Yeah.
West Side Story by Robert Wise. It hits an 8. And that puts it between the movies. I mean, just it's all in alphabetical order. It's on the bottom of the 8s, right under The Terminator. And it's above American Fiction, the first of the 7.75s. So it's at least as good as those movies, if not better. West Side Story. I don't know. I think if you give West Side Story an S tier like they would in 61, that seems to be a little overrated.
Mm-hmm,
but
mm-hmm.
I think an 8 score is great for any movie.
Absolutely.
So
an 8 is a definite watch it.
We're not saying it's bad, but it's not as good as there. We've already discussed a couple that we think are better.
It's no Singing in the Rain.
No, it's not.
It's not.
Yeah. But that said, what is next? It's not a Chorus Line. Cabaret.
Yes.
Is next Wednesday. So come back for us there. Another classic that I will be discovering for the first time. And so like, subscribe, check the show notes for links, other places to find us, leave a comment. Rate us if you're able to rate us anywhere on podcast apps that do so. If you have a friend that likes movies, specific type of movies, you know, each month it's different. So maybe people might get more into this theme than the others. But we're always going to be generally about the world of movies. So if people go in and out of that, depending on the topic, I understand, you know. But we do have some loyal listeners out there that listen to it all. And I hope we can at least instill broad respect and love for the art of filmmaking, period. Because, you know, I feel like we don't consider ourselves experts and enthusiasts. It's like we're putting ourselves through an education.
Absolutely.
You never stop learning. So get your tarragon asses back here on Wednesday. And for Cabaret. All right? We love you.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Our mothers all are junkies. Our fathers all are drunks. Golly Moses, naturally we're punks.
Gee, Officer Krupke, we're very upset. We never had the love that every child ought to get. We ain't no delinquents, we're misunderstood. Deep down inside us, there is good.
There is good.
There is good. There is good. There is untapped good. Like inside, the worst of us is good.